complete honor to stand before you tonight. It's amazing when you ask Jesus to be your Lord and Savior, your healer, your deliverer, and one who sets you free, what he will do with that opportunity of your choice to say yes to him. How many of you like to see dreams come true? Me too. So I'd like to invite my dear friend and sister in Christ Jesus, Mary Gardner. I would also like to invite Amazing Grace, who I knew before she was born because her mommy was like this. And Amazing Grace, through the years, as she has grown and started to sing, we have had opportunities to sing the national anthem together and do some things for through Exchange Club for our police and first responders. And I am so thankful that she has made Jesus her Lord and Savior and shines so brightly and shares her gifts and talents with those that are around her. And I'm also thankful for Miley, who the moment I met her was like God highlighting her heart to say, watch and see what I'm going to do with this one. So without further ado, I'd like them to come forward. They're going to sing. And this is a dream come true for Miss Mary Gardner, who doesn't share her dreams often with many people other than her spouse or occasionally individuals, but she did. And when she did, I said, Lord, I love to see dreams come true. If there's any way that I can be a part of it, let me know. And this opportunity came.
Like a sound of a symphony to my ears. It's like holy water on my skin.
Woo, Jesus.
Oh, 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 yeah.
Dead men walk enslaved to sin. I want to know about being born again.
Take me to the riverside. Take me on to better times. I need you.
Oh, Lord,
how I need you. Your forgiveness is like sweet, sweet honey on my lips. It's like a sound of a symphony to my ears. It's like holy water.
like sweet, sweet honey on my lips.
Yes, it is.
It's like a sound of a symphony to my ears. It's like holy water. Your forgiveness.
Yes,
it's like sweet, sweet honey on my lips.
Yes, it is.
It's like a sound.
Water on our skin. That grace of God, His unmerited favor. We stand in awe of what His blood through His redemption does in each of our lives. Thank you, sweet ladies, walking out their dreams. Amen. Speaking to you about grace. God's grace is a free gift from God that we do not deserve and cannot earn. It is often described with terms like undeserved or unmerited favor. Grace is an expression of God's love and mercy towards us, towards each and every one of us. The reason why the balloons are here is because you are celebrated. You are celebrated. Some of you came in with so much on your mind and in your heart and your emotions, the things that are taking place in our world and the things that are taking place in each of your lives and things that are taking place in your sphere's work and your friends. If it's not happening to you, then it's around you. And when you walk in to the house of God, God says, forsake not the gathering together. And why is that? So that we would be encouraged, undergirded, and lifted up by the body of Christ. So tonight, when you walked in, I wanted you to know, not just know, but see and hear and feel and taste that God is good, regardless of the situations or the circumstances. God is faithful, and his word is truth, and he is not a God that lies. So we can trust him and put our confidence and be reassured in him. And he's the one that created you, and he's the one that brought you in these doors tonight, for such a time as this. All of heaven rejoices when you ask Jesus to be your Lord and your Savior. He loves you so unconditionally. There is people around you that love you with condition. But God so loved you, he sent his son to die for you. That's unconditional love. And he's a God, when you love him, it's reciprocated. It's unlike any other kind of love. And that is our Abba Father, our El Shaddai, our Jehovah Jireh, our Elohim. He is our everything. Even when we are undeserving, the biblical definition of grace is the unmerited favor of God. It is kindness from God that we don't deserve, but it is one that we can receive. Grace has the power to transform individuals, communities, and societies. It empowers individuals to break free from the cycle of sin by providing the strength and resolve to make positive changes in our lives. Grace instills a sense of hope and possibility, enabling individuals to believe in our capacity through Jesus Christ. For transformation and growth, when we allow the grace of God to work in us, we become more loving, compassionate, and forgiving towards others. We become agents of change in our community, and we are shining. We have a choice in that grace to be a shining light of Christ and bringing hope to those around us. All right, when this all started, I said, how many of you like to see dreams come true and hear about dreams coming true? Amen. And you say amen, and you raised your hand. Well, I wanted to highlight a couple of devotions in Pastor Jim's new deliverance devotional book, soon coming available to you and to others. In day three. So it's not one that he just talks about. It's not one that we counsel about. It's also something that each of us can take and say, that's for me. So in day three, it says standing strong. You then, my son, be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus. The first thing you have to do when things start falling apart is to be strong yourself in the grace that is in Christ Jesus. That is a fundamental principle of helping anybody. You can only pass on to others what you yourself have received, repented, and overcome. That's the truth. God's grace alone is strong enough to handle the pressures of a fallen world. But the only way you can lay hold of the grace of God is to acknowledge that you are weak and you do not have anything else to hold on to but Him. Recognize your weakness and then accept God's promises to work with you and through you in your weaknesses to make you strong and your testimony for Him strong. How many know that when you're going through a test and you process through that test with Jesus, He will give you a testimony? And it is beautiful that you have that testimony to share, because then you're relatable, you're authentic, and you're very real. And anybody that knows you will know if you're saying a story that you just heard or if you've lived it. God's power is more significant than any other. Standing strong does not mean you will never face trials. In fact, facing those difficult situations is what produces character inside of us. Gold must be put through the fire so that it can be strengthened, purified, and refined. Fire increases the value of what's inside us. Just as Jacob wrestled with God, we must be willing to do the same. It's not a sign of weakness to wrestle with God or to go through trials getting rid of impurities. It's not fun or easy, but it is vital. So in Romans 5:3-5, it says, not only so, but we also glory in our sufferings, because we know that suffering produces perseverance, and perseverance character, and character hope. And hope does not put us to shame, because God's love has been poured out into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. Put your hands on your heart. Holy Spirit has been given to us. Thank you. You're looking at a new me. You were taught with regard to your former way of life to put off your old self, which is being corrupted by its deceitful desires, to be made new in the attitude of your minds, and to put on the new self. Put your hands on your heart. I want to be a new self. In Jesus Christ. Amen. However, when we come to Jesus, He no longer sees us as sinners, but as saints. We are no longer identified by our old life, but by the blood of Jesus that has set us free. You are now a saint saved by grace. See the difference? Jesus' sacrifice has given each one of us the ability to live out our new identity, or rather the identity He always wanted for us, a child of the Most High God. Put your hands on your heart. I am a child of the Most High God. Yes, you are. Take every thought captive under the obedience of Christ. I was listening to Robert Morris, another pastor, and he had a prayer of declaration. So I want you to close your eyes for a minute and listen to this prayer of declaration. I declare today that in Jesus, your love, your power, and your goodness, and your empowering grace all flow through me, producing fruit naturally and shaping my desire and appetites. Appetites. Good and noble things overflow out of my life organically and effortlessly. Peace, joy, and confidence shine from me, making me a beacon of light to the lost and hurting. Because I am absolutely secure in your love, acceptance, I am unoffendable. I am patient, and I am full of grace for others. For me, and every day is a day of Sabbath rest. Amen. You can open your eyes. Now, in the end of the devotions, it'll give you a prayer and a life application. And it might sound something like this. Darkness is the absence of light. Like apathy is the absence of action. Write another list of God telling him how he can use us to see other people set free from this very thing. Isn't that beautiful? We want to be set free. Have nothing to do with fruitless deeds of darkness, but rather expose them. Put on the full armor of God so that you can take your stand against the devil's schemes and lies. And we were taught about taking on the full armor, the helmet of salvation, the breastplate of righteousness, the belt of truth, shod my feet with the gospel of peace, shield of faith, and sword of the Spirit. And if you want any of those papers, we'll have them out in the front. We can make more copies. In him, we can live sinless lives. This is the glorious gospel of hope. There is a way, but there is only one way. He does not wave a wand or jump out of a lamp and poof, there he is. You are all children of the light and children of the day. We do not belong to the night or to the darkness. I am the way, the truth, and the life. There can be no truth apart from Jesus. He who conceals his sin does not prosper. He who confesses them and renounces them finds mercy in Proverbs 28:13. So, as a child of God, and we're overcomers by the blood of the Lamb, there's often times when we're going through trials and tribulations and we're like, Lord, I'm not seeing this in my life. I'm not feeling this in my life. And I'm not supposed to be moved about how I feel, but I'm supposed to be moved by the gospel of Jesus Christ. So, at those times, in Galatians 2:20, which is one of my life scriptures, it says, I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. And the life I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loves me and gives himself for me. If you need it, you can come and get it after service. It's free. Philippians 4:13, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. I choose to do all things through Christ who strengthens me. So you can say, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. It kind of sounds like a question like, I can. But God gave us a free choice to choose. So do you choose to think, to meditate, to be a part of the Word of God? Do you choose to say and to do, I can, I will do all things through Christ who strengthens me? So some things that you might be asked to do in Christ Jesus, you might walk around like, you asked me what? You asked me to say what to that person? I don't know them. I know you don't know them. That's the walk of faith. You have to choose it. So when I was in Bible college, I don't know if you heard this story, but I was first year. I didn't know what faith was. I came from a Catholic background, which was beautiful because I learned the awe of God. And in learning the awe of God, it was powerful. But when I went to this school, Jerry Savelle's Ministry International, every time there was a preacher or a pastor or an evangelist or prophet that got up and talked about faith, I didn't know what that meant. And I said, God, I don't know what that means. I don't know what that means. I don't know what that means. And I was kind of shy and backwards. And I was like, I don't even know how to ask them. They're going to be looking at me like, You came here. What are you doing? I'm like, I don't know. I'm just being obedient to Jesus. So I was sweeping and cleaning one day, and I heard, get a pen and paper, get a pen and paper. I thought the dean walked by. Get a pen and paper. I was like, who is he talking to? So the second time I heard it, I go out there, and I'm like, is the dean out here? No, dean's not here. So I go back in, I'm sweeping, and I hear, get a pen and paper. I'm like, that has to be you, God. That's so like, audible, new, okay. Heard you in my heart before, never like. So I go get a pen and paper, and I write down faith, F-A-I-T-H. And he said, F, focus your A, attention, I-N-T, the H, Holy One. Who is that? And I said, that's you. And he said, that's right. Don't be persuaded to the left or right. So what is this? What is this red right here? What is this all about? It's because in God, in the blood of Jesus, in the grace of God, that is his unmerited favor. And yet it's an empowerment. It's a gift to us that we can be empowered. We don't have to walk in inabilities. We can be empowered by he who lives and dwells within us as mortal bodies. We can have that resurrection power of life dwell within us to raise us up every day and do what he's called us to do. And by that bloodline. So this is a bloodline. This is the altar where we come and say, God, I don't know what this faith is. How do I become saved? How do we become healed? How do we become delivered? How do we become set free from those things that are here and those things that are here and those things that are all encompassing around me? How do I walk this faith walk out? Focus your attention in the Holy One. Focus your attention in the Holy One. Focus your attention in the Holy One. Do not be persuaded to the left or the right. Do not be persuaded by the left or the right, or whoever's talking to the left or to the right. Be persuaded by the blood of Jesus that paid the price. In Psalms 23:3, he restores my soul. He leads me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Isaiah, I'm getting a glare, 40:31. But they who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength, and they shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. So when you're here and you're like, I'm getting a little weary in my well-doing, then you need to say, okay, Lord, I'm going to trust you, and I'm going to step up like an eagle, and I'm going to soar above, and I'm going to ask for heaven's perspective. I'm going to ask God, what is your perspective on this situation, circumstances? What am I to say? What am I to do? What am I to be praying? How do I intercede? What is it, God? Give me your discernment. Give me your words. Give me your presence, because it's here in me. So I receive you. I receive your presence. I receive your wisdom, your counsel, your guidance. I thank you, Lord. Wow, it looks so different here. Kind of scary. But God will have you do things that in the natural make you scary. But in the spirit, you're like, whoop, whoo. I just got a ticket to a Holy Ghost ride with Jesus. Fasten your seatbelt. Get ready. Hold on. If you have to do this or you have to do this, like, woo-hoo, get ready. Because a life in Christ is beautiful. Even through the ups and the downs, we can still put our praise on. And we can still worship him in spirit and in truth, because it is he who delivers us from this. So we think higher because he teaches us how. So I've got all kinds of mirrors here. There has to come moments when you choose to believe what God says about you and no longer listen to the lies of the enemy. Says you're chosen, you're loved, you're forgiven, you're seated with Christ, full of authority, filled with the Holy Spirit and God's delight. Time is going so fast. And when you're preparing, you're thinking, oh, How much time do I got?
So we were in staff a couple weeks ago, and Pastor David says, oh, my title for Wednesday is Just Say Yes. And I'm like, and he looks over and he goes, you can do Say Yes too. And I was like, okay, God, really? I mean, I know that I believe in confirmations, but really? I'm like, okay, God, you got something else? Okay. Flexible, moldable, be the clay. He's the potter. Oh, okay, stretch. Mm-hmm. Good thing is elasticity is not only in our skin, but it's in our spirit. Okay, 10 stakes. Okay, 10 stakes. Here we are. Here we are. Feel the pressure. Here we are. If you didn't, how about this? So then, a day before Wednesday, Tuesday, he comes in and he goes, oh, so I've got this Esther video. And I'm like, I'm like, God, are you kidding me right now? They've never done this before. I mean, I believe in confirmation, but really? So he was like, he's looking at me. I say nothing because I'm like, mm-hmm. You go, God. Mm-hmm. Okay, if you're going to confirm this, you're going to, okay. Don't be stressed. Don't be worried. Worry and anxiety is not of you. Okay, I lay myself at the foot of the cross. I'm going to sit at the foot of the cross. Mm-hmm, Jesus, help me, God. You know, every once in a while, beautiful Pastor Pat, she'd come in and she'd say, Natalie, I got to preach on Sunday. And Jesus better just talk because I ain't got nothing. Give me your hand. So I graciously just hold her hand and say, oh, yes, dear Jesus. And I would pray, and I would pray. Well, come that Tuesday, I had my moment without Pastor Pat, and I'm like, I'm right there, God. I'm right there. I need you, Jesus. So without further ado, I would like you to watch a video on Ephesians.
Paul's letter to the Ephesians. The story of how Paul came to the city of Ephesus is really interesting. You can go read about it in Acts chapter 19. Ephesus was a huge city. It was the epicenter of worship for most of the Greek and Roman gods. And for over 2 years, Paul had a really effective missionary presence there, and lots of people became followers of Jesus. Years later, after being imprisoned by the Romans, Paul wrote this letter. The movement of thought in the letter divides into two really clear halves. In the first half, Paul is exploring the story of the gospel, how all history came to its climax in Jesus and in his creation of this multi-ethnic community of his followers. The second half of the letter is linked to the first by the word therefore. And here Paul explores how the gospel story should affect how we live every part of our life story, personally, in our neighborhoods and communities, and in our families. So let's dive in, and we can see how Paul develops all of this. Chapter 1 opens with a beautiful Jewish-style poem where Paul praises God the Father for the amazing things that he has done in Christ Jesus. From eternity past, the Father has purposed to choose and bless a covenant people. And think here, the family of Abraham and Genesis chapter 12, verses 1 through 3. And through Jesus now, anyone can be adopted into that family. Jesus' death covers our worst sins, our worst failures, and in Jesus we find God's grace. In fact, Paul says, that grace has opened up a whole new way for us to understand every part of our lives. He says in chapter 1, verse 10, that God's purpose was to unify all things in heaven and on earth, under Christ, which is a title that means Messiah. God's plan was always to have a huge family of restored human beings who are unified in Jesus the Messiah. This divine purpose became clear, Paul says, when we were first made into that family. And here he's referring to ethnic Jews in the family of Abraham. But then Paul talks about how you, and here he means non-Jews, you all heard about Jesus and the salvation through him. And you were also brought into this family by the work of the Holy Spirit. And so here he's referring to the events told in the stories of Acts about how God's Spirit brought together Jew and non-Jew into one family in Jesus. It's just like God promised to Abraham long ago. Notice also how in this poem, Paul begins by talking about God the Father, but then about Jesus the Son, and then here at the end about the Spirit. All three work together as Paul tells the story of the gospel. It's really cool. After the poem, Paul responds with a prayer. He prays that these followers of Jesus would not just know about, but personally experience the power of the gospel, that they would be energized by the same power that raised Jesus from the dead and placed him as the exalted head of the whole world. Now in chapter 2, Paul goes back and he elaborates on some key ideas from the poem in chapter 1, especially God's grace and this new multi-ethnic family of Jesus. He begins by retelling the story of how these non-Jewish Christians came to know Jesus. Before hearing about Jesus, they were physically alive, but they were spiritually dead. They were trapped in a purposeless life of selfishness and sin, and they were deceived by dark spiritual forces of evil. But amazingly, God, in his great love and mercy, he saved them, he forgave all of their sins, and he joined their lives to Jesus' resurrection life, and he's brought them back to life too. And so now, having been created as new human beings through Jesus, they have the joy of discovering all of the new calling and purposes and tasks that God has set before them. Not only have they been shown God's grace, they've also been invited into a new family. Before hearing about Jesus, these non-Jewish people, they were not just cut off from God, they were cut off from his covenant people, the family of Abraham, and for a really practical reason. The commands of the Sinai covenant, they formed like a boundary line around the family. They were like a barrier that kept most non-Jewish people away. But in Jesus, the laws of the Torah have been fulfilled, and the barrier is removed. The two ethnic groups have become, as Paul puts it, a new, unified humanity that can live together in peace. So Paul goes on in chapter 3 to marvel at the unique role that he got to have in spreading this good news to non-Jewish people. And even though he's in prison, he's thanking God for the chance he's had to see this covenant family grow so huge. So Paul closes the first half of the letter with another prayer. This time, he prays that Jesus' followers would be strengthened by God's Spirit to simply grasp and comprehend the love that Christ has for his people. The second half of the letter begins with Paul shifting gears, and he starts challenging the reader to respond to the gospel story by how they live their own life story. So he starts in chapter 4 with just the everyday life of the church. The church is a big family with lots of different kinds of people, but he emphasizes that they are one, and one is a key word in this chapter. They are one body that's unified by one Spirit. They have one Lord with one faith. They have one baptism. They believe in one God. That's a lot of unity. However, Paul says, unity is not the same thing as uniformity. He goes on to explore how Jesus' new family consists of lots of very, very different kinds of people, but they're all empowered by the one Holy Spirit, each using their unique talents and passions to serve and to love each other and to build up the church. And here he uses two really cool metaphors. One is building up the church as a new temple, and the second is that they are all becoming a new humanity with Jesus as the head. And this new humanity is a metaphor he's going to then run with for the next couple chapters. Paul challenges every Christian to take off their old humanity, like a set of old clothes, and to put on their new humanity, in which the image of God is being restored. And he then goes on into this long section where he compares this new and old humanity. So instead of lying, new humans speak truth. Instead of harboring anger, they peacefully resolve their conflicts. Instead of stealing, new humans are generous. Instead of gossiping, they encourage people with their words. Instead of getting revenge, new humans forgive. Instead of gratifying every sexual impulse, new humans cultivate self-control of their bodily desires. Instead of getting drunk, new humans come under the influence of God's Spirit. And he spells out what that influence looks like in four different ways. The first two have to do with singing together, but also singing alone. And this is really interesting that the first thing that Paul thinks of about how the Spirit works in the lives of Jesus' people is singing and music. The third sign of the Spirit's influence is being thankful for everything. And the fourth is that the Spirit will compel Jesus' followers to put themselves underneath others and to elevate others as more important than themselves. And Paul actually expands on this fourth point by showing how it works in Christian marriage. So you have a wife who follows Jesus. She is called to respect and to allow her husband to become responsible for her. And the husband is called to love his wife and to use his responsibility to lay down his selfish agenda and to prioritize his wife's well-being above his own. And Paul says it's this kind of marriage that's actually reenacting the gospel story. The husband's actions mimic Jesus and his love and his self-sacrifice. The wife's actions mimic the church, which allows Jesus to love her and to make her new. Paul then applies the same idea to children and parents, as well as slaves and masters. Paul closes out the letter by reminding these Christians of the reality of spiritual evil. These are beings and forces that will try to undermine the unity of Jesus's people and to compromise their new humanity. And so Paul challenges them to stand firm and to put on this metaphorical set of body armor, which he describes in detail. And Paul has drawn all of these pieces of body armor from the book of Isaiah and how Isaiah depicted the messianic king. And so now, as the Messiah's followers, we need to make the Messiah's attributes our own since we make up Jesus's body. Practically, I think Paul means for Christians to begin to form habits, proactively using prayer and the scriptures and our relationships with each other to help us grow and mature as followers of Jesus. And that's the letter to the Ephesians. Very powerful. It's where Paul summarizes the whole gospel story and how it should reshape every part of our life story.
Aren't you glad that I didn't read you the whole book of Ephesians, but then you got to watch it like this? Because believe me, the thought did cross my mind and I went, oh my goodness, their little eyeballs would be going. I could have stayed home and read that myself. But this, I love the way that we have so many ways to learn the word of God. So I would encourage you to listen to podcasts, to read your word, and to look up these videos so that you can grow and learn. There's so many ways to grow and learn. Do not allow the enemy to come to steal, kill, and destroy because you don't have a moment here on this day, but you do here on that day. It is vitally important that you get into your word every day. And so, yes, these beautiful pages that are written for life are for us every day, every minute, every hour of our day. In Psalms 51:10, it says, create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me. Why is a broken and contrite heart necessary in our relationships and services unto God? It is so we can please God. And Pastor Jim puts it this way. It defines and contribute as being sensitive enough to grieve over our sins and shortcomings, and not just being sorry we got caught in doing them. There is a difference between being sorry we were caught and being sorry that we caused God pain. And so the book of Ephesians teaches us several lessons, and we can do nothing to earn our standing with God. We are His holy temple and dwelling place. We are bound in unity and other believers. We are to walk worthy. We are to be equipped with purpose, and He equips us with purpose by the Holy Spirit, by grace, by mercy, by faith, by love. Put off the old self. Put your hand on your heart and say, out with the old self. Holy Spirit, have your way in me. Jesus, you are my master. You know, in Romans 10:9-10, it says, believe in your heart and confess with your mouth and you shall be saved. So if you haven't made Jesus your Lord and Savior, I would pray, just as Romans 10:9-10 says, believe with your heart, confess with your mouth, and you shall be saved. Be imitators of Christ. Let your marriage model the gospel and train your children in righteousness. What we give full armor to. I loved the list of what we lay aside and then what we put on. That was powerful. So I woke up early this morning and the Holy Spirit was so cool. I love when the Holy Spirit talks to us and we listen.
It's so much better than not listening. Because then you're not repenting later like, oh, I should have really got up and done this. But these balloons here are to let you know that you're not only loved, but that you can step out from the norm. And so I have three pictures that they have of people that have stepped out of their situations and circumstances. And I want you to go ahead and show those. I have one. Do you have them up there? Yeah, one. He was born with no limbs, no arms, no legs. And yet, this beautiful man of God, this powerhouse for Jesus, has not been limited to the power of God living and dwelling within his mortal body to raise him up every day and do what he's been called to do. And he is globally known. And it is phenomenal. He has a beautiful wife and beautiful children. And you talk about God's unconditional, unwavering love to connect you, to make way for you. And so whether you've had an amputation, whether you have had cancer, whether you have had or wear glasses or hearing aids, that is not a lack of faith. Jesus loves you. He heals. He delivers. He sets us free with all those things. I'm on my knees because I was in boots because I had fragmentations in my feet. And it is a miracle and a sign and wonder that I stand. And I thank the good Lord for his healing power. And so you coming in this door, you are a sign. You are a wonder. You are a miracle. Because of the things that you've lived through or that you've heard or that you've seen. You are blood bought, blood purchased, and Jesus absolutely loves you. Second person, Beth Hamilton. Is that who's next? Yeah, go girl. She's the one that was, is a famous surfer, and she was bit by a shark. And she's married and pregnant and adorable. And you talk about elasticity in one skin. Hello, girls. Thank you, Jesus. So I am so thankful that she said yes to Jesus and she's serving Jesus with all her heart. Don't limit yourself. And when you limit yourself, say, God, I dare to believe. I dare to believe past what I feel or what is trying to move me. I'm not going to buy the lie. I'm going to receive your truth and I am going to do exactly what you would have me to do. And the next one is, yeah, Joni Ericinstata. I don't know how to say her name right, but I'm so sorry. But she paints with her mouth and she is a beautiful Christian evangelist that has a beautiful ministry. And again, it's all about not limiting yourself. There is no limits in Christ Jesus. The Lord wants dreams and visions that he places within you to come to full flourishing. Full flourishing. Transformed to be activated and empowered to step up and step out of our carnal old self and into all that our Abba Father, our Lord Jesus Christ, created us to be as his mighty King's kids. Grace, unmerited favor, empowered by the gift of grace to step up and step out. Old ways of thinking, old ways of doing and thinking we were right, old ways of feeling, he wants us to step out of those. So tonight, I am going to ask you to step out of your seats and walk these blood lines that represent the blood of Jesus that was shed for you to get up and walk out. And he showed me this honey, sweetness on his ears and lips. When he hears us speak the word of God, And when we're kind and we're loving and we're joyful and we are walking in the fruit of the Spirit, taste and see that God is good. I literally can see oranges being squeezed, lemons and limes being squeezed, and seeing the citrus smell, and you can see, and you're like, man, God, you're mighty. You made this. So there's little tiny honey jars in each of these sacks, and it says thank you, because God is thankful when you choose to walk in what he tells you to walk in, and walk in his word. Then these two little mints are encouragements. The encouragements is, do you know, when you give an encouraging word, you could be giving a course change in somebody's life. I come against that demonic spirit. I come against death. I come against self-inflictions by the blood of Jesus. You are valued. You are made worthy. Your life matters. When one dies, there's a trickling effect. Then there's a little slip that says emergency Bible numbers. And so it says, in case you're angry, to let go of grudges, when in need of hope, et cetera, et cetera. What is this about? When I first started and I worked at the front office and I'd get these phone calls, it's like you're a 911 service. I mean, you could specialize as a police officer and you know these. You can be a doctor and specialize in different things. No. As a minister of the gospel of Christ, as a minister, as a king's kid, you're going to be called upon as like 911 service. And there was times I would open up my little devotional book and I was like, they're angry, Lord, they're angry. Okay, sweet Jesus, obra santoria, see you. I'm praying in the Holy Spirit. And now I'm using emergency tongues because they're really desperate and they need an answer. And oh my goodness, in myself, I can't do it. But you know, in Christ Jesus, okay, you said, okay, and then I'm going to pray accordingly. And then they're crying and they're weeping and they're like, thank you so much. And I'm like, thank you so much, Jesus. I mean, I'm getting off the phone and I am crying and I'm like, oh, that was so you, God. Well, you know, we're all there. We're all learning. So that's what this sack is for. And so this goodie bag is for you to take home tonight. And then these balloons here, this red represents our hearts. And so if you need to give love, or you need to forgive and you are brokenhearted, or you are grieved because you have had a loss. On Monday, I found out that Dr. Savelle, that he passed away. And I sobbed. And I was like, sobbing. And I was so sad. And I thought, I only had 2 years in Bible college, but I am like, oh, grieved. My heart is broken. I learned so much in that time. I learned faith there. I'm so thankful for those seeds that I went overseas to Africa, to Kenya with my classmates. It's the first time that I stood in line the first year and said, I'm going to Israel, and I had no money and I had no ticket. So then I learned about faith, foolishness, and presumptuousness. Okay. But in the bathroom, a man got saved. So, okay, we can learn that up. But the second year, I actually saved and prayed and saved and prayed, and then I did get to go to Africa. So that was a big deal. So I want you to take a pen. Don't take it really. I only have a few. But if you have a pen at home, take it home. Or if you want to sit here and have time here with Jesus, then I would encourage you to write a message. And if somebody's no longer here on the earth with you and you didn't get to say your final goodbyes, I would encourage you to write a note, clip it, and let it go. And just say, Jesus, you hold my heart. And, or I have a broken heart and I need to release that brokenness or unforgiveness. And the smiley face is, if you wanted to make somebody's day, write a scripture on it. I believe in you. I'm sending you big hugs, loves, kisses, and prayers. Well, that's my thing. But you do your thing. Then this purple is righteousness, identity in Christ Jesus. You have been made righteous. You have been made right standing with Jesus as his Savior. And if somebody needs that encouragement to know their identity, this is for you to take and to ponder, think about, and then bless. And then there's a gold balloon, and that's for the treasures that we are in Christ Jesus. And we each need to know that we're seen, heard. We're seen and heard. God sees you. He hears you. He knows you. Is your name written in the Lamb's Book of Life? Because he sent his son Jesus to pay the price. So tonight, in closing, I just wanted you to know that Jesus so loves you, he wanted to celebrate for you. And he made provision for you. So as you think about what balloon am I going to take and what balloon will I take to give to somebody else? How will I step up and step out of my own natural comfort zones? And I will step up and I will step out and do what he is guiding and leading me to do. Father God, I thank you that it is a divine appointment for those that are here and those that are out in our live stream listening. Father God, I thank you for your blood that covers and protects us. I thank you for your grace, the unmerited favor, and yet that empowers us, equips us, and anoints us. I thank you for the Holy Spirit, how, Father God, as we trust in the Holy Spirit, that he teaches and guides. And if we're that student, we can be leadable, guidable, teachable. So Lord, I thank you that you've given us each flexibility in our skin. May we be just as flexible in our skin, in our spirit, to say, yes, God. Yes, God, have your way. Have your will. God, I thank you that it's no longer I who live, but you who liveth and dwell within me. And because of who you are in me, if the person standing in front of me needs a preacher, a teacher, evangelist, a prophet, then God, raise up those words. Give me your presence, your words. I receive your presence, I receive your word, and I walk in it. I step up and I step out. I step up and I step out. I do it everywhere I go, in my car, before those that I love, and before friends that I love and care about, before strangers. May I be a reflection of you. May I be a bridge maker so others would come to know you. May I be an extension of heaven to earth, what you've done through me and in me. Through the test, may there be your testimonies. And Lord, I thank you for ministering to every heart, to every mind, to every emotion, Father God. I thank you that angels of the Lord do encamp about us and that we entertain angels. I thank you, God, that each one that is present tonight will walk out different than how they walked in. If they walked in with their heads held low, I thank you that through you, we can put our shoulders back and raise our heads and say, okay, God, you've got me. If you're in, for those that are out there live streaming, if you're in your car, you're in your home, you are lavishly loved by the blood of Jesus. And we want you also to stand up and step out into all the fullness that God would have to see dreams come true, to see situations and circumstances come true, that your life is important, and that we do not want suicide. We don't want drugs and alcohol. We do not want the things that would be deterrent than how God you would have us to be. So Lord, we thank you. We thank you for your son, Jesus Christ. We thank you tonight. We thank you. Every hour in our day says, pray without ceasing. How do we do that? We say, God, we thank you. We thank you. We praise you. We just lift our hearts. Every situation, circumstance, lift your heart to him. Lift your prayers to him and let him empower you and equip you. In Jesus' precious name, amen.